Hello and welcome to part one of two of my new series, Flashback Friday. Over the next two Fridays, I'm going to be bringing you some of the highlights and the most memorable moments of 2020 and those who I had the privilege to interview this year. So it's a fairly jam-packed schedule for tonight's show, so better get cracking. First up is, of course, your favourite racing Geordie, slowly but surely working his way up through the ranks and making an impression on and off the track. Coronavirus definitely was not going to be stopping this lumberjack from getting back out on track at the Scarborough Gold Cup there a couple of weeks ago. The following video is a clip from my interview with the one and only Dominic Herbertson, where he tells us a slightly random fact about himself.
My mum's got me finger in a freezer.
What?
Do you know I lost my finger?
No. Oh my God.
I've got it on video. Do you want to see it? Okay. Basically, right, I crashed at the Sunflower 2 years ago, the Sunflower Road Races. Through this. So anyway, I had to, when I woke up, they said, all right, we need to cut your finger off. I'm like, what the hell's going on? They unwrapped my finger. I said, right, well, can I film you cutting my finger off? And this doctor's going, no, you can't. And so anyway, I'm having an open argument with this surgeon, this doctor, saying, look, can we cut your finger off? I'm like, no. And I'm going, well, you're not cutting it off unless he let me film it. So anyway, after 10 minutes of arguing, he let me film it. Now, are you sure you want to put this on?
I'll put graphic on the script.
Right. So, is them.
Oh! Is that your finger?
Yep.
That's the end of that.
So, anyway, what I thought. Oh, I know, it's mental, isn't it?
So
that was all that, I can't remember. I can't remember getting on the bike or anything. So I woke, so anyway, I thought to myself, I'm going to take that finger home. And I gave it, so just for a bit of, we've got a very dry sense of humour where we're from in the Northeast. And by the time I got home, I went, Mum, I've got you a present. She goes, you what? I went, shut your eyes and put your hand out. And obviously it was my finger in this pot. So she went, what am I going to do with that? I'm like, I have no idea, Mum. It's still in my mother's freezer at her house.
Oh, God.
So that's an interesting fact, I suppose. And that's all I've got going for this week.
I think that's going to top them all now, to be fair.
I don't really know how we are going to top that, but maybe a few words from the fastest man on two wheels might just do the trick. Yes, back in May, I got the privilege to speak with the world's fastest road racer, Peter Hickman, and I got his view on what it was like winning at the Isle of Man, and of course that memorable year in 2018 with BMW Smith's racing team. Take it away, Peter.
Three wins out of the six races is not bad, of course. We always want to win all of them, but that's not always possible. But, considering a brand new motorcycle that had never been to the Isle of Man TT before, we'd only had it for a couple of months by the time we went to the TT, literally a couple of months, the end of March was when we got the bike. So it was still very, very new. So to be able to actually win with it in two races is pretty credit. Was credit to the team. As much as me riding, it's credit to the team, the whole Smith Racing team. And we also obviously got the little triumph up on the podium and actually won a race with the triumph as well, which was fantastic.
Yeah, brilliant. It's a great year for
everyone. Yeah, absolutely. That. And I'm coming off the year before where we obviously broke the lap record with the old bike, if you like. There was a bit of, not pressure, I wouldn't say, not on me anyway, but on the team to make sure that they performed like they did the year before. And, you know, they came out and did exactly that. So I couldn't have asked for any more from the team or the bike or anything. They did such a good job.
You were just saying there, right, there was no pressure. Like, how would you, do you ever feel the pressure going to races like that? You know, like going over to the Isle of Man, you know, it's such a high profile event, I suppose. Do you ever sort of feel, God, like, you know, I have to perform? Or do you just kind of block it out and just do what you have to do?
Yeah, for me, I just do what I need to do, you know. I try not to overthink things. That's a big thing for me. I'm just pretty relaxed about the whole job. I'm there to go and enjoy myself as much as it's my job. I'm there to enjoy myself, and I'm there for myself first and foremost, you know. And the team understand that, and they know that as well. They've never put any pressure on me whatsoever. And to be honest, I don't really feel like I ever get any pressure, you know. I'd say because I'm there for myself to enjoy myself, I don't really feel like it's a job almost. So, I just kind of get on and and ride, and fingers crossed, obviously, we end up winning. That's the aim of the game. But if we don't, then I need to learn from it, understand why we didn't win for whatever reason, and then come back the year after and try and put that right.
Well, there you have it, Hickey's thoughts on his TT and the success that he has had. Another man who has had some success over on the island, winning three himself and, of course, setting the lap record in 1992, is, of course, world champion Carl Fogarty. Back in June, I caught up with a four-time world champion where he discussed his love-hate relationship with the infamous Laguna Seca course.
And I suppose each and every track that you ride on the circuits, has its own obstacles and challenges that that you have to overcome, I suppose, as a rider. But one track in particular that I wanted to ask you about that proves very difficult for a lot of riders is the corkscrew in Laguna Seca. What did you make of this circuit?
I hated the circuit, if I'm honest. It didn't suit my style at all. At the time, I couldn't figure out what it was about the circuit. It's only when I look back now, in hindsight, you kind of, the way I was as a rider, I used to let go of the brakes into the corners and get on the gas very quickly. I mean, lean angle, corner speed. But on that circuit, you could not do that at all. I couldn't figure out why. It's just the layout of the circuit. It's very flat cambers, not really any cambers at all, really. So the first two parts of the circuit, I really, really struggled at. I really did. Every time I tried to go fast, I wanted to do what I wanted to do. When I tried to, I'd always lose the front end of the bike and crash. But the only bit of the circuit I actually liked, I was fastest through, well, regular every year, when you used to get the split times in the first three sectors, you know what I mean, of the whole lap. And then the last sector was the corkscrew to the start and finish line, and I was always one of the fastest. They always pass through chicanes, and I kind of dissed it a little bit, really. I was like, typical me, people bang on about the corkscrew. I said, yeah, it's just a downhill chicane, that's all it is, no big deal. But I was always very fast through chicane, and the next two corners after, up to the start and finish line. But the rest of the circuit, I really did struggle with, and every year I had to fight so hard there to get like a top six place, really. It's the only place I never ever won a race. And of all the places I race all over the world, every country, it's the only place I never managed to win. I nearly won there in 1997, but got pit by John Kaczynski, who was probably one of the fastest ever guys to go around that track, to be honest. So, it wasn't my favourite circuit.
And then moving on from the circuit racing, you did compete on the roads and the road racing over here in Ireland and the Isle of Man. What was it like, the transition from the roads, or from the circuits over to the roads?
It seemed very natural for me. A lot of riders do struggle with it, but I didn't have a problem with it, really. I mean, the funny thing was I won my first World Superbike race in 1992. And 2 months later, became the fastest ever guy around the Isle of Man TT circuit. So the transition for me was fairly easy, to be honest. Not many could do it, not many did do it, not many wanted to do it. But I feel like I started my career more on the road circuits first than before the short circuits, really. And I think when I look back on my career now, those are the times I missed the most, really. I just love racing in Ireland, the Northwest, and the Ulster Grand Prix. I always had a great reception over there. I was going really well with the fans and stuff. And, I think they admired the way I sort of rode on them sort of circuits, And then obviously won the TT, and I was Joey's teammate for a year or two at Honda in sort of 1989, really, I suppose. I didn't have a problem with the transition for both. Like I said, in fact, all the years, somebody already reminded me of this recently, actually. I said, you actually realise that all the years you were racing on short circuits, from 92 to 99 to 2000 when it all ended, you were still the fastest ever guy around the Isle of Man TT circuit all the years I was racing on short circuits. I thought, oh my God, yeah, because I lost a race on a road circuit in 1993. I finally won the Northwest 200 after years of bad luck. I finally won both races in 93. So that was, it would have been my last ever race on the road circuits. After that, it was all the short circuits and the world championships. But at the same time I was doing that, I was still the fastest guy around the TT, which is something I look back now, I'm very, very proud of, really, yeah.
Carl, of course, one of the most successful world superbike riders, and always up for a bit of crack, and just an all-around nice guy, I suppose. And just on that note, speaking of all-around nice guys, my next guest is one of two brothers from Northern Ireland, having raced in the British and World Superbike Championship, and of course now his new role in BT Sport. It is, of course, the one and only Michael Laverty. He spoke to me earlier on this summer, telling me a little bit about how he became involved in motorsport and motorbikes. So, take away, Michael.
From we were 3 and 4 years old, he had little, it was 50cc QR Hondas were the bike to have back then, which became a PW50 a few years later. But we grew up on farmland at home, and me and my brothers just used, we rode about together and watched every single GP race that was on the television. So there was a passion that grew for bikes and for bike racing through my father, but we never really saw it as a career. It was just purely for the love of it, for the love of riding bikes, for the love of getting outdoors. And we never really even considered racing until a friend of ours from a few miles away decided to go to a local race. So we followed suit, and then we ended up all three of us making professional careers out of it.
And then in 2003, you were picked up by a racing team before in 2004 signing your first professional contract. And how did this come around, you know, getting your first professional contract? Because obviously it's a big deal. Like,
yeah, it was tough for a few years. We were a family-run team. So actually, my brother-in-law is now one of the best crew chiefs in the world. He works with Top Rack on the Yamaha World Superbike team. But he was with my older sister, and we traveled together, and we learned how to set the bikes up. And all of a sudden, we started to get a little bit more successful as a private team with very little money. And in 2002... I had a very small budget, and it was kind of my last throw of the dice, because I knew I couldn't really afford to race at that level much longer without a lot of support. And I won quite a few super sport races that season, and then by the end of 2002 I was getting approached by a few of the teams in the British Championship about riding full time. And at that time I wasn't deep in my studies, but I was studying IT, I was in college, and I had to weigh up whether I was going to try being a professional bike racer or continue with my studies. And obviously the bike racing won out, so it was nice. At first I didn't earn any money other than prize money, which you could earn back then. You don't get prize money now in the British Championship. I had a few personal sponsors that helped me. Racing at home in the Irish Superbikes back then used to be supported by cigarette money. So there was the Lambert and Butler class, the Regal class, and the Super Kings, and there was good prize money then, so you could actually earn a little bit of money through that. And if your costs of going racing weren't too expensive, then you come out on a plus, or at least even at the end of the season. And then I got picked up by Paul Bird in 2004, and that was my first actual paid contract to race bikes. So it was nice to then do what you loved. So getting up in the morning to go training to ride bikes was never difficult, because I absolutely love it, and I still do to this day.
I always find it so interesting listening to everyone's personal stories, I suppose, about how they became involved in the industry, and so many different avenues that people have gone down to get to where they want to be, I suppose, within the sport of motorbikes. And that can kind of be said for any sport as well. Hard work and dedication can get you anywhere, and that's been proven by listening to these guys this evening. Moving on now to a feature video that I did back in June for the annual Skerries 100. I caught up with some of the people who help make the event as successful as it is year after year. This included 2018 Manx Grand Prix winner Andy Farrell, the overall race sponsor Michael Hoy from Country Crest, co-race and rider sponsor Ollie Grimes, and of course Martin Scully, the chairman of the Skerries Chamber of Commerce.
Myself, I had no personal history with it, and it was when the likes of Andy Farrell came to me and asked me to get involved. I was kind of going, well, what's this really going to do for me? But being community orientated and that, I decided that I'd give it a go. And we decided to do a fundraiser on the first year, and it turned out to be absolutely fantastic.
You've been going to race at the Skerries 100 for many years now, and you also play a crucial part on committee. What is the transition between racing and organising like?
Well, for the past number of years I've been on the committee whilst racing, so I'm pretty involved all along, so it's not much of a transition. Always going to the meetings.
Multitasking.
Going to the meetings regularly and always paying attention and being told what's going on. So you kind of know the setup of the race and, you know, what's coming next, or what the club has to do to get the race on the road, you know, and get things running. So, yeah. You know, just being there, it's going to help actually now that I'm supposedly retired. So we'll see how that goes.
I don't think road racers ever retired though, really.
No. I'd ride a bike somewhere, but I don't think I'd be back up the hills.
It's been great though for you as well in 2018 when one of your riders, Andy Farrell, won over in the Manx, you know, on the bike that you sponsored.
It was absolutely magic, you know, because as soon I was listening behind the scenes to what was going on, but within seconds of the race being over, Fran was online, you know, and obviously crying his eyes out with happiness, you know, delighted for Andy, delighted for all the work that they put in, and for the years of working, of course, him himself working on the bikes to make sure the machines go, but for Andy it was absolutely fantastic to cap it there. You know, it was absolutely fantastic.
It brought a brilliant buzz though home to the town of Scaries as well. And I'm sure being your local track, you're going to miss, if you are retiring, you're going to miss going around there at crazy speeds.
Yeah, it's one of those things. I've been going since a kid and, you know, it's a bit of an evolution. I feel like I can give more back to the club and more back to racing. You know, I think I've achieved all I've known to achieve on the roads other than about there myself, just to enjoy spinning around. You know, with the club, I see the work that the club does, and there's an awful lot goes into it, and an awful lot of preparation, and an awful lot of work to be done. And, you know, with my experience of racing and around Scaries, you know, I can probably put that a little bit more back in, and, you know, help riders and have the, you know, an eye from a rider's point of view as well to put back into the club and see how it goes from there, you know.
So Michael Hoy here from Country Crest. Obviously there's no racing this year due to the coronavirus pandemic, but how's, just aside from the racing, how's business been with you at Country Crest?
It's business as usual. It's difficult times, it's difficult for everybody in the workplace and just minding everybody and making sure that they're safe. But apart from that, it has been pretty much normal for us.
My earliest memory of the race is when it actually came through to town. As a young fellow up in a field of hay, and the local coal man's name was Tom Redmond, and he gave me a kick up the arse for walking through the hay while it ploughed across Hillside, as is known, or Miller's Lane, and under the bridge. So that's 50 years ago. So long memories and good memories.
And then you've sponsored and supported the Luxury Motorcycle Club now for many years. What satisfaction do you get out of sponsoring an event that's really put Scaries on the map?
I think that it's probably one of the best community events that's run in this country, and it's great to be a small part of that. We have a very tiny part in that. It's easy to come up with some funds or whatever, but the lads themselves and the girls, the amount of work and effort they put in, it's a whole year's work for one day, and it's just fantastic to see what they actually do. And then when it comes to the day of the racing, the actual buzz that it brings around the whole community. So it's very much worth being part of it.
This year in particular, as you say, with the coronavirus, it is going to impact the business around town.
Yeah, well, we've walked around the town earlier, lots of people out, but still lots of businesses closed. And if you hadn't been here this time 2 weeks ago, all the businesses were closed. So just people out, but no money circulating. So it's been a tough year.
It's brilliant. It's brilliant for the town. We love it, you know. There's festivals on in different towns around the country, and the Scaries 100. We're absolutely famous for it, you know. So it's there in history, and you know, sad obviously to see that everything has stopped this year, and now we know what we're missing out on. But now we know what we have to look forward to in the future.
Roll on 2021.
Well, it's safe to say a good day was had by all behind the scenes in creating that video, and thankfully it wasn't too blustery down the beach with the hair. If you know, you know. Up until now, we've looked back at interviews with riders, sponsors, supporters, riders turned presenters, but we haven't spoken about the Travelling Marshals. Earlier on this summer, I caught up with a retired Travelling Marshal from Scaries, Sam Taylor. Sam told us a little bit about the roles and responsibilities and what it takes to be a Travelling Marshal. Sometimes I feel like, you know, people like the spectators and people that are on the outside forget the role that a travelling marshal, like how crucial the role they play is. Like, what are the tasks that a travelling marshal would have to undertake?
It can vary from very small things to major things. Like, just before races even commence, we have to make sure that all the gates are closed, all the ropes are up, all the spectators are in behind, all the ambulances are in position. And then when it comes to more, when the bikes are getting going, one of us will always lead a warm-up lap, or the five laps for the newcomers, which has to be gradually progressed from speed, so to get used to the track. At the first lap of the race, there's always a group of four of us at the back, be it a doctor, paramedic and probably two traveling marshals.
Okay.
And we usually have this rule because it takes two people to remove a helmet should there be an incident the first lap. Usual things are from the road race, you see one or two going down rather than just one. So you need two people there to remove a helmet, so that's why we have four at the back.
Thank you very much, Sam, for that insight into the roles and responsibilities of a travelling marshal on race day. Right, so our last interview for this Flashback Friday is, of course, multiple Northwest winner, TT's British champion, Macau Grand Prix winner, and the list goes on. So I'll just let him speak and tell you a little bit about himself. It is Steve Plater.
He's a retired motorcycle racer, Steve Plater. So I suppose everyone watching this is going to be going absolutely mad. We asked him this question to literally everybody I've had on. But how have you been getting on throughout the lockdown? And I suppose how's the transition now kind of coming out of it? How is it kind of the transition coming back to normality, I suppose?
First of all, I feel quite hurt. You know, to be gold retired makes me feel really flipping old. It's bad enough my daughter's giving me earache about being old and getting on a bit.
Well, it was either ex-gold racer or retired. Retired
nice or so. No, I'm only joking. I've really loved it. You know, the kind of the lockdown. I mean, earning zero, of course, is an issue. However, yeah, loads of free time, gives you a chance to get caught up and to live like how we used to years ago to a certain degree, and just kind of being a relaxed fashion with everything from going out doing a bit of running to working on my own places. It's been lovely, it's been great. But of course, you know, BSB started back up again, so I'm busy looking after the Decatur Traction Cup there. So, you know, and various of them got various testing programs and things on. So it's kind of catching up and real busy again, so it's nice.
And so now we've done the whole lockdown thing, and not to make you feel old again, well, you're not old, but, so you began racing in the mid-90s, and you took your maiden win in Caldwell Park on the circuits. So starting out, you obviously started out on the circuits. Did you kind of start out circuit racing thinking it'd be a pathway into road racing, or were you just kind of using this as a platform to start racing? Kind of, how did it all sort of come together?
You know what? I'm a bit of a kind of a freak of nature, I suppose, because I started racing very late in life. You know, I was riding around on a road bike with friends, and back then, the same as everybody else, being a bit of a lunatic and touch wood, getting away with it. Me and myself and three friends, we went on a race called at Cadwell Park, and this was 1993, so quite a few years ago, and you got about 20 laps on track, and it says, oh, you're really good, you should have a go at racing. And I was kind of getting a little bit fed up with doing the same thing and riding around like a lunatic, so I kind of decided to sell my road bike and buy a race bike, and that's where it all kicked off. But there was no interest at all in doing it professionally or for a living. It was purely to get away or get that adrenaline out of the system at the weekend on a racetrack and have a few beers on the night before in the clubhouse and just do what everybody did in those days and enjoy the weekend.
Well, that's the end of part one of Flashback Fridays. I hope to see you in the same place at the same time next Friday for some more of my highlights and memories of 2020.
Been getting me into speedway, so I'm now really keen to have a go on a proper speedway track.
God.
I was there.
Yeah.
My one problem with the Northwest 200 is trying to keep Philip on a lead that I can find him. He's always running away from me. To go and talk to people, and just a way to get some information for you. That means he's going for a cup of tea.
I used to do a couple of days at the TT in 2009 when I was just starting out really as a presenter.